This is a different hat that I wear, one that I did not ever want, but God chose differently. He has a really weird sense of humor. I told my dad when I was 16 years old, the last thing, my dad, by the way, pastored for 52 years, and I told him when I was 16 years old, the last thing you will ever catch me doing is standing behind the pulpit preaching, because I know how people treat preachers. I grew up with one. God's got a really weird sense of humor. He allowed my dad to live long enough to see me eat every one of those words. Psalm 37, 4 and 5 is what we're looking at. Delight thyself also in the Lord, and he shall give thee the desires of thine heart. Commit thy way unto the Lord, trust also in him, and he shall bring it to pass. I want to speak to you this morning on this subject. Happy in the Lord. Happy in the Lord. Now you notice I didn't just say happy. I didn't say how to be happy. I said happy in the Lord. There's a difference, and I want you to see that difference for these few moments this morning. You say, we're supposed to be finished at 8:45. I'm all too well aware of that, and I'm a Baptist preacher, and I'm as nervous as you are. But let's see if we can do it, all right, by the grace of God. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for your word this morning. Lord, I thank you for the opportunity to do my best as one of your servants to explain to these folks how we can leave here today realizing the difference between this carnal flesh and the spirit man and the one we should pay the most attention to. I thank you for burdening my heart with this message. Allow it to be food for our spiritual beings. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen and amen. How to be happy in the Lord. Well, let's see the difference in the definitions. That's the first thing I want us to look at today. Happiness. If you look up the word happy, it has everything to do with the carnal flesh, the outward man. Things that take place in our lives that cause us to smile. Different things have different responses. If someone called you after you leave this building and said, there has been a gross mistake in your income tax, and we, the government, owe you $1 million. Now, first of all, if they did, they'd figure out a way to keep it. And we know that. But if that took place, you would smile. You might even shout. You could possibly pass out. All of those responses take place when you get this news. I'll never forget when my wife got the news that our son was on his way. That was a smile that's different from any other smile I'd ever seen on her face. And she told me, and I was so thrilled. Happiness. But when she told me that, there was more to it than just physical satisfaction or gratification. Something happened on the inside of me when she told me that news. That's what I want you to see the difference in today. There's a difference between smiling and being happy and someone making you happy and pleasing you and doing what you've asked them to do. There's a difference between that and being blessed. There's a reason why Jesus used the word that he used in the beginning of the Beatitudes and the different reasons why. Blessed are they. There's a reason Jesus used that word, and I want us to see that reason for just a moment. The word is makarios in the original text. And it literally says to make yourself. One of the versions, one of the keys in that long description of definition, makarios, is to make yourself happy in God. How do you do that? That's what I want us to look at. Number one, we understand his word. We understand his word. We realize that this right here is the infallible, inerrant word of God. Inspired by men of God.
so that we could have what we know is the greatest guide to anyone's life that you will ever find.
Right here it is.
We need nothing else but this. We don't need another lecturer. We don't need another course. We don't need another weekend engagement somewhere where someone's going to try to tell us how to deal with our neighbor.
This will tell you how to deal with your neighbor. Sometimes love is easy. Sometimes love is tough. But it's still love. And it's up to those of us that understand the difference between being carnally, fleshly, happy on the outside and understanding the blessings of God that are ours because He's just God and He loves His children. There's a big difference. And understanding His Word is the very first way, the very first key that we need. How do we understand His Word? Why do we want to understand His Word? Well, let me say it like this. In the deepest, darkest hours of my life, so far in my 50 none of your business years that I've been on this earth, there's one verse that feeds me. When God challenges me to do something, this verse feeds me every time. And it comes to my heart. Why does it come to my heart? Because I have absorbed it into me. I've memorized it. There's so much of it in me that I now know and understand. The Lord is my light and my salvation. Whom shall I fear? When darkness comes, the Lord is my light and my salvation. Whom shall I fear? That's just one verse. Out of 66 books. There's a lot more to feed us every day of our lives. And when we begin to understand His Word, we want to know more about His Word. When we want to know more about His Word, we get fed more. You know, when you're a baby, all you get is milk for a while. Then all of a sudden they start introducing my granddaughter, my beautiful granddaughter. I've seen this process in the last just a little over a year now. And I've watched it yet again come alive to me in my life. As a born-again child of God, I watched that baby. And it's the very equivalent. And for a while, all she can handle is milk. And anything else is going to be rejected. She can't deal with anything more than just milk. And then all of a sudden, one day they start introducing these elements into her. And just little by little. Not force feeding her a steak when all she can handle is milk. But then she gets to the place where she needs more than just milk to satisfy her hunger. That's the way a child of God is. When we've had milk for a while, then all of a sudden we start this growth process. And when we get to a certain place, we hunger after more than just milk. And before long, we're eating steak. And we understand the deep things of God. How do we get there? By understanding His Word. The psalmist said it like this, "Thy word have I hid in my heart, that I might not sin against Thee." Why did the psalmist say that? Because it is a reality of life. We deal with all of these real things in our lives every day, day after day after day after day in our life. We deal with real things. We're real people. We deal with real things. And then we depend on a real God to help us through those things in which we have to deal. And if we don't, what happens? We make a mess. But if we depend on Him to get us through it, then the outcome is far better. It pleases Him. And if it pleases Him, it brings Him glory. Then at the end of that result, we're going to have peace like we never thought we'd have. Amen. Understanding His Word is the first key. Number two, we must understand His work. Understand the work of the Lord. How do we do that? Well, my favorite passage in the Scripture is the most widely known passage of Scripture, even to those that don't know anything about the Bible.
And I think it is the single greatest explanation of understanding the work of a holy God.
When Jesus said, "For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life." Not a better description of understanding the work of God than realizing what's going to take place right here. Jesus is making the statement to a certain character in the Word of God.
Why?
Needs to hear it. But you look at that moment, and then you look when we get to the cross of Calvary. And Jesus says these words, "Father, into thy hands I commend my spirit." And he gives up the ghost. He dies on that cross. God, man, dies on that cross. And ringing through history as we walk back from that day, backward to that moment when he makes this statement, "For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life." All of a sudden it means something different than just quoting something that somebody has said so many times that we now know what it says. But knowing what it says and knowing what it means is two different things. Understanding his work produces a result that is eternal. You and I need to understand that the work of a holy God is very simple, but it is everlasting. We make it difficult. We make it something that it's not, as far as I'm concerned. And then last, let's look at this. We understand his worth. Understand his word. Understand his work. Understand his worth. What is the work of God worth to you? What is God worth to you? What is Jesus and the finished work at Calvary worth to you? It's imperative that we, if we want to grow as the children of God, we have to understand his word. We have too many people that don't know what happiness is. So if you want to be happy, then you have to understand the difference between happy and blessed. You say, "You've already said that." I'll say it again before I'm finished. Why so repetitive? Here's why. Because we don't get it. I don't get it. We hear it, but we don't absorb it. When we start viewing everything through the eyes of blessedness in our lives, many things will change in our lives. If it feels good, let's do it. That's what the world says. If it feels good, do it. Well, very often feeling good doesn't get it done because it lasts this long. Just like anything in the temporal is going to, it lasts just for a moment. Now, listen to me. When we understand his worth in our lives, it's when things can change in a moment's time for us. It's when things can go from "this is okay" to "wow." And you can't explain it because man didn't do it. And I watch and I'm finished. Understanding his worth. Jesus said, "I am come that you may have life and that you may have it more abundantly." How many of you have abundant life today? How many of you couldn't raise your hand? Is it because you've got the definition put in the wrong place, or are you just using the wrong word? Are you blessed, or are you just happy? Because if you're happy, the opposite of happy is sad. Jesus said it, I am come that you may have life, and you may have that life more abundantly. And then in Luke, the Gospel of Luke, he makes this statement, behold, I give unto you power to tread on serpents and scorpions, and over all the power of the enemy, and nothing shall by any means hurt you. I believe Jesus meant every word of that when he said it. He's talking to the 70. You know, at first he had the 12. Those 12 decided to be followers of Jesus. Then these 12 go out, and then all of a sudden he's speaking to this new group, 70, that's going out, sending out 70 now. And they come back with great stories, rejoicing that they have the demons of hell under their feet. Now, I want us to look at something. Let's look at that next verse for a moment, and then we're going to be finished. Luke 10:19 is the one that I just quoted to you. Giving power, treading on serpents and scorpions, and power over all the enemy. But let's look at 20. Let's look at verse 20, and I'm going to be finished. Notwithstanding in this, rejoice not, that the spirits are subject unto you. What is he saying? Hey, don't be thrilled to death about the spirits being subject unto you. That's just a part of what this is. It wasn't a big deal to Jesus. That was part of the work. It was also part of the worth of Jesus. That's what he's worth to me. He holds those things at bay. He holds the devils of hell at bay. He keeps them from me. Notwithstanding, in this rejoice not, that the spirits are subject unto you, but rather rejoice because your names are written in heaven. Amen. The single greatest peace that you'll ever know, the happiest condition that you will ever experience, the greatest reality of blessedness in your life is when you understand God's Word. When you understand God's work. But beloved, let me say this to you today. When you get to the place where you truly understand God's worth in our lives and what it took for us to be able, as carnal fleshly beings, to have this thing inside of us called the spirit man, who knows stuff is going to get worse here, but I am a pilgrim passing through a strange land, and one day soon I won't have to worry about this place anymore, and I'm not going to have to cross Jordan alone. Amen. Realizing that if your name's written in the Lamb's Book of Life, you're blessed, highly favored, a prized possession to a holy God. If that doesn't make you happy, nothing.